Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
When you go before our Heavenly Father in prayer, what is your objective? Are you more interested in God hearing you, knowing what you want, knowing what your desires are, or are you very different from that? Are you wise and mature spiritually, knowing that it's much more important for you to hear from God, that you would receive His guidance, His instruction, so that you could carry out His purposes, His plans, His objectives, rather than wasting your time and doing something that is displeasing to Him, and that is asking God to do your will? We need to realize that God's plans, His program for your life, is by far the perfect program. Nothing that you could come up with, nothing that you could want, nothing that you could dream about is going to bring you eternally the joy, the satisfaction, and having the influence from His purposes and His standpoint in this world. Nothing's going to cause you to be more valuable in this world than doing what God would have you to do. It is when we submit to the things of God that truly our life becomes meaningful and of value. Well, take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Matthew in chapter 22. The book of Matthew in chapter 22. Now, we have seen that Yeshua has had many encounters with the leaders from Jerusalem. And sadly, they did not come with the right intent. Instead of listening to Him, wanting to receive truth, understanding a kingdom perspective, having a better understanding of Scripture, they weren't open to any of these things. They came, as we have seen, in order to entrap Him, to test Him with the desire that He might be shamed publicly, that they could embarrass Him and discredit Him before others because they had already determined they were against Him. And why? Why were they against Him? Because He was not teaching what they wanted to hear. And realize that if your faith in the living God, in His only begotten Son, is so that you can hear and receive and become what you want to become, that is not how a true disciple of our Lord and Savior behaves. So again, look with me to Matthew chapter 22, and we're going to begin in verse 34. Now, hopefully that you'll remember last week in our previous study, Yeshua met a group known as the Sadducees. And they came with the scoffing attitude concerning the reality of the resurrection, meaning this: they did not believe in the afterlife, in the kingdom of God. And therefore, they tried to as well to discredit Him and entrap Him in some example that they came up with, and He shamed them. He, as hopefully you'll remember, He told them what their problem was, and that is, they did not know the Word of God, and therefore they did not know the power of God. And may I say to you, in all seriousness, do you know the Word of God? Because if you're not embracing Scripture in the proper way, understanding the truth of God, you will not be a recipient of the power of God. And without the power of God, you won't be able to do the purposes of God. And when you are not doing the purposes of God, your life is not going to have any eternal value. You are not going to be having the influence in this world that you were saved to have. And therefore, you are going to be in rebellion. And when you're in rebellion against God, you know what you're going to be experiencing? Frustration. You will not know peace. You will not know contentment. You will not have that inner satisfaction. And even though you may be suffering in this world, that joy, that contentment, that inner peace is going to cause you to overcome anything, and I mean just that, anything that the world might throw upon you. So let's begin verse 34. We read here, the Pharisees, after hearing that he, and this would be Yeshua himself, Jesus of Nazareth, after hearing that he had silenced the Pharisees, the Sadducees. These Sadducees had come with that question concerning the resurrection, and when Messiah got done responding to them, they had nothing to say. They had failed. He had silenced them. And what do we know? Well, the Pharisees, they weren't giving up. They came, and notice what it says as we read on. After hearing that he had quieted the Sadducees, we find that the Pharisees, they gathered unto him. They came once more to him. And look at verse 2. And this would be a word many of your English Bibles would translate it a lawyer. But it's not a lawyer in a secular sense, but rather it is an expert. And I want to emphasize that. This one would be an expert in understanding the Torah, that is, the laws of God, his commandments. And because he's a Pharisee, he would also and primarily understand how the Pharisees, the traditions of men, how they said these commandments should be applied to one's life. So obviously, they brought to Yeshua in order to test him and discredit him and shame him, they brought one who was very, very wise, one of their experts in the law, and as it says, in order to test him. And this is testing for the purpose of bringing failure. Look now to verse 36. And he was saying, teacher, which commandment? And he wants to know, which one is the great commandment in the law? What is the most important? What is that commandment above all others? Which is the greatest? That's his question. And Yeshua said to him, gave a straight answer. He says, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul. And here it's with all of your mind. And this means the very essence of a person, every part of one's being. So he simply did what Yeshua normally does. And that is to quote scripture from the book of Deuteronomy, for example, chapter 6 and verse 5. Something, by the way, that in the Jewish community, each day in the synagogue in the morning, also in the evening service, and once again, before we retire upon the bed, we say the same scripture. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And then we continue on in the next verse, V'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha, b'kol levavcha uv'kol nafshecha uv'kol me'odecha. Just what it says here. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your very essence. Here we find the Greek word with all of your mind. And then notice what he says in verse 38. He says, this is the first, meaning this commandment should be the priority of your life. If you're not interested in demonstrating, showing your love of God with your heart, with your soul, with your very being, then you are not a disciple of God. You are not a servant of God. You're not serious about this covenantal relationship that one was brought into. If you come from a Jewish perspective, you're talking about the law of Moses, that covenant. If you're coming from a believing perspective, and I hope you are, then you're speaking about the new covenant. And that new covenant is connected to the Abrahamic covenant that we read about in Genesis 12. So Yeshua answered this way. Look again in the verse 38. He says, this is the first and the great commandment. And it's first, as I said, a priority. And great is this. It is going to have the greatest outcome, the greatest influence in a person's life. Now, he answered the question, but notice he continues, verse 39. And the second is like it. Now, what's the second one? Well, it's not second in order in the sense that this one, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. This is not the first in order. We have to go back to the book of Genesis to find the very first one. But it's the one with the greatest priority. It's foundational. And it brings about the greatest outcome in a person's life. To love God in this manner. And the second one, he says, is like it. Why? Well, it begins with that same phrase. V'ahavta. You shall love. Here, of course, it's in Greek. But he says the same thing, look if you would, to the next end of verse 39, where it says, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, what is this teaching all about? Messiah is showing something. First and foremost, these two commandments are foundational, we'll see this in a moment, for not only the law, the Torah, but also the prophets. And when we encounter scripturally that phrase, the law and the prophets, what we're speaking about is, from an Old Testament perspective, the Bible, the scripture. So we see that this law and what he said about it, loving God, loving your neighbor, it is the expressiveness. It expresses the very essence of the Bible, of scripture, of God's revelation. And that is why it's so important that we do not just cast aside the Torah. Because the Torah teaches us about God's expectations. That we are people who should first love God. And here's the reason why I put these together. It is because I love God that I am going to love my neighbor. Now, this is connected to what we said a few minutes ago, and that's this. If I love God, then I'm going to want to love my neighbor and be a proper influence in his life, a godly influence. I want to be an instrument, a vessel of God that brings the changes in my neighbor that God wants. Not what I want. Not trying to manipulate him for anything, for my purpose, my benefit. It's not connected to me whatsoever. I want to influence that person so God is pleased with him. That person becomes a recipient of the blessings of God. That's my motivation. And when we look at the Ten Commandments, we see a connection. Because many of those Ten Commandments, they relate in our responsibilities to God. And the others of those Ten Commandments relate to our responsibility to others. So the Ten Commandments fall under these two commandments as well. Love God and love your neighbor. And when we look at the Torah, it's all about demonstrating love. First, our love for God. And how do we do that? By demonstrating our love for others. Now look at verse 40. He says, Messiah is still speaking, In these two commandments, all the law and all the prophets hang, meaning this. You can take anything, this is his intent, you can take anything that is recorded in the law, the Torah, or you can take anything that's recorded in the prophets and take that truth, that principle, that revelation, and hang it upon these two commandments. They summarize the purpose, the will of God for my life. God wants me to love him, and I demonstrate my love for God by loving my neighbor. It is because I love God that I'll love my neighbor. It's because I love God that I want to be a blessing to my neighbor, bring about God's purposes in his life, in her life. That's what it's about. That's what I have been saved to do. So Messiah says all of these things concerning the law and the prophets and how they relate to these two commandments. Now, notice no response from anyone, because these answers that he gives are exactly the truth of God. No debates, no arguments, no one can stand in opposition. And notice what happens as we move towards the end of this chapter, verse 41. But the Pharisees, having gathered, meaning that they came before him, notice that Yeshua asked them. So now they had drawn closer unto him. And I believe that's very, very significant. He had heard, or they had heard, how he had answered this question. And for the first time, this brought them closer to him. What it literally says is that they assembled themselves to him. And notice how Yeshua is going to take advantage of this opportunity. Now, we have seen in our study of Matthew how frequently Yeshua will tell his disciples, shh, don't say who I am. And the reason why he did this is because most of the people, they were confused about the purposes of Messiah, what he came into this world to do the first time that he came. He wanted to set in order a proper understanding of the person and the work of Messiah before he revealed he is the Messiah. And now notice, this is one of the first times that Yeshua, that he initiates the question. He asks the question. He's not responding, but he answers as they gathered unto him. And Yeshua, he asks them, saying, what to you seems concerning the Messiah? Now, I translated this very literal. What he says to them is this: what does it seem to you concerning Messiah? Now, that is simply an idiom in the biblical language for this. What is it that you think about the Messiah? I want you to think about him for a moment. And then he continues on. He says, whose son is he? Now, we see many times that when people responded to Yeshua, they cried out, Son of David. Now, in the Bible, we see that Messiah reveals himself as a suffering servant, and the rabbinical commentaries and the Talmud and the Mishnah, they speak about this suffering servant as Messiah ben Yosef, meaning Messiah, the son of Joseph. Why? Because Joseph, and I'm speaking about the Joseph, the son of Jacob, who was captured and sold into slavery in Egypt, this one who proved to be a savior of the people, not just the people of the world. And what do we know about him? Well, anyone will tell you that Joseph, he's a typology for Messiah, meaning this. The more we study the life of Joseph in the book of Genesis, the more we understand about the work of Messiah, what he was going to bring about. But for the most part, Judaism, and this is true to this day, really doesn't pay much attention to Messiah, the son of Joseph. They focus more on Messiah, the son of David. To the extent some of the rabbinical scholars, They say this whole concept of Messiah ben Yosef is canceled out, done away with. Others simply don't put any emphasis on it for another reason. Now, we know there's not two Messiahs, as Judaism says, but we know there's only one Messiah, but he has two very different roles. When he comes the first time, he's coming to redeem, coming to pay the price, the shedding of his blood. He's coming to be, as Paul says, our Passover lamb. But when he comes again at the end of this age, he's not coming to suffer. He's coming as that ruling king. He is going to fulfill all the thoughts of the people concerning Messiah, the son of David. And that's why when he asked this question, look again, verse 42, where he says, whose son is he? And they were saying, of David, meaning the son of David, verse 43. Now, he knew exactly this is how they were going to respond. And what they understood about this term, Messiah, Bar David, meaning Messiah, the son of David, what they understood about that is that he is a physical descendant of David, meaning this, he would come after David. If he's a son of David, he has to come after King David, after David. He has to be an offspring of him. Now, in one sense, that's true, but that does not give us the full understanding of the personhood of Messiah. Even though Messiah entered into this world as a descendant from the tribe of Judah and from the family of David, that does not mean that is where he originated. We've said many times that Messiah, he is eternal. There was never a time he did not exist. And this is exactly what Yeshua wants to teach them about himself. So they say, he is the son of David. Now verse 43. He says to them, that is Yeshua, he says to them, therefore, how did David say in the Spirit, and the Spirit calls him Lord? How is it that David, I'm speaking about Psalm 110, this is where this citation is from, and again, so frequent Messiah turns to Scripture to give revelation, to share the truth of God. So he says, the Scripture, how is it that David, in the Spirit, says, and he calls him Lord? How is it that David calls this one Lord, saying, the Lord said to my Lord, sit here on my right hand until I should set your enemies as a footstool for your feet. Now, this is what is mentioned in Psalm 110, where David wrote down, and here, remember what Yeshua said, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He said it in the Spirit. And what did he say? He quoted, the Lord, meaning God. We would understand that, God the Father. The Lord said to my Lord, who's that? Mashiach, the Messiah. So God said to the Messiah, sit here on my right side until I set your enemies as a footstool for your feet. Now, David saying this implies something, and that is that the Messiah is his Lord. And this is exactly what we read in the Scripture. Look now to verse 45. Therefore, David calls him Lord. How is it that he is his son? So he says, yes, he's a descendant, but David calls him Lord. And all of this points to, and here's what I want you to see, all of this points to the divinity of Messiah. That he is not a mere man. He is fully man, but he is also fully God. And when he was born into this world, when he was conceived by the Holy Spirit in the womb of Miriam, that is Mary, this is not where his existence began. Again, you need to learn this phrase. There was never a time that Messiah did not exist. He is the eternal Son of God. If you don't believe in the divinity of Messiah, you don't know the biblical Messiah. And if you don't know the biblical Messiah, you are still lost in your sins. And therefore, this scripture is so important, and what he's saying to them is foundational. What he's saying is, you need to get the right understanding of who I am, who the Messiah is. And I say to you, that may be very appropriate for you. If you don't know him as the living God, as the Son of God, the divine Son of God, God himself, Emmanuel, God with us. If you don't know him in this way, you need to make a change. And that's what he's saying to these Pharisees. You need to know the truth. Look now to verse 46. And no one, none of these Pharisees, none of these wise individuals in the traditions of the elders, none of them were able to answer him a word. Now, what do we see here? Well, remember, this section, this last section, began with the Pharisees coming to Yeshua. Why? When they heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, that they had nothing to say. And what's the implication? The Pharisees were saying, well, we're going to bring our best one out. This one who's an expert, he will test him. He will show contempt for him. He will manifest that this one does not know anything. And what happens? Yeshua takes this simple truth from the Psalm of David, Psalm 110, and in the end, they were not able to answer him a word. And no one dared to say anything from that hour on, and they were no longer asking him anything. There was a change because he revealed his true identity. You need to know the true Messiah.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.